And second episode. Let's see if it's better than the first. Now, according to the editor's notes, Celestial is supposed to be pronunciated Celestial. And it's supposed to be a Latin name meaning heavenly. I would like to look that up, and I think there's a few things wrong with the way he used it, especially the fact that there is no ch sound in that name. But I wouldn't know. I live in a world where everybody's still convinced that Aang is pronounced Ong, and that Sokka is pronounced Soka, and Iroh is pronounced Yiro, and I'm shocked that they actually let Zuko go by without mispronouncing that name. Episode 2, Feather Buster Blusters. I'm going to enjoy these names of these episode titles that the writers of the show gave me, because they're so much fun. The Dark Stranger returned to his home. In the dark, dark house, in the dark, dark street, on the dark, dark corner, there was a dark, dark house. Inside the dark, dark house, in the dark, dark cellar, some skeletons lived. A big skeleton, a little skeleton, and a dark skeleton. Wolf. All but covered in strange darkness, with occasional lightning strikes flashing. Oh, wow. Real inventive decor there. Ever considered getting something that has drapes or something? The area was all barren and desolate, laden with destruction and devastation everywhere. Question for the audience? Why make it like this? I mean, why not make the place a little bit nicer for your henchmen? Add a pool room, a hot tub, a jacuzzi, something? In the center of the wasteland was a very large creature. Oh, shoot, it's Chernabog. The same size as the new Canterlot Palace. He seemed to be made entirely out of dark energy, forming his large body and two large, glowing red eyes. Of course, it's a formless entity of nondescript evil. It's usually a not nameless form of the entity of the nameless evil. Look at Titan. He barely had a form. A surprise that he gave forms to Chrysalis and Fratillo and to Spear. Guys, when you create something like this, try to be a little more inventive. Like, for instance, I got this great design called Dark Conquest. I know it's an OC typical red and black alicorn design, but I want to go with that because it would make sense. He's going for a Gary Sue type of design. It'd be actually kind of cool, but I'm trying to figure out how to make him unique. Hello. He spoke in a very deep, dark, sinister voice. What have you to report, Nomad? Nomad? That's demon spelled backwards! No. I refuse to do the backwards name things. No. They don't make sense. They sound ridiculous when you say them out loud. And there's no purpose! Now, if he was from a mirror universe, sure, I would understand. But there's no purpose for him being named backwards. It's just only there just so it could sound unique, and it doesn't. Demon bowed to his leader. Apology, Your Majesty. As per your orders, I succeeded in making my way to the distant past. I got you some new drapes if you want some.
Why, thank you.
Dark King glared down.
Tell me why you haven't succeeded in conquering the era.
Begging your pardon, Majesty, I've ran into a few obstacles, and on top of that, my precious cardinal, the Flamestrikes, was beaten. I thought his name was just Flamestrike, not the Flamestrikes.
Your excuses bore me.
Why? Why, villains, do you always do this to your henchmen? Why can't we ever have a bad guy who, cares about his generals, likes his henchmen, and actually realizes that if you continue to abuse your workforce, you are going to lose money?
Make General nice.
As his voice echoed along the darkness, Demon felt a little nervous deep down.
He knew that displacing Dark King was highly excusable and meant danger. You know how vitally important your mission is.
If he knows, why do you need to repeat it?
Said Dark King, we have conquered this pitiful world and many others, but it is not enough. In order for me to gain complete mastery and dominance of all that exists, we must wipe out those who oppose and defy us. As I am unable to travel to the past,
why?
I guess we'll find out later. I trusted you to make my dream a reality.
So again, we have another guy who wants to send villains out at one at a time, rather than sending out the whole entire general forces.
My brain hurts. Demon bowed again and said, I assure you, Your Highness, victory is within our grasp. Though I was unsuccessful the first time, it was merely by a small fluke. We mustn't forget that they come from an era so primitive to that of our world, and their disadvantages serve us well.
Makes sense. I mean, I can understand how primitive people would lose to a more advanced society. I wonder how that some of those primitive people won out against some of my advanced societies.
Oh yeah, some of them lost. Dark King hesitated for a moment and then said, very well, you may continue. But be warned, any further blundering and you will suffer the consequences.
Demon sighed confidently and concerned, but asserted his king to victory before he left. Yoink! Okay, I know I seem to be complaining like this, even though I'm a fan of Sentai and Rangers. That's mainly because a lot of times in the Sentai, their plans aren't to world dominate. Their plans are more for trying to cause mayhem, destruction, or just general chaos. Or they have specific missions that they want to carry out. It's rare that they actually want to take over the planet. And there's usually a reason if you pay attention to the dialogue in each Sentai of why there's only one MLTW per day or one general. Even Sailor Moon has gone with this, as Pharos' whole entire ideal was not to take over the world, but she just wanted to gather energy. Why? Because she was just trying to buy her time until she could find the Silver Imperial Crystal. And her four generals, and this is a line of dialogue that I'm kind of annoyed that Deke took out. In the original Japanese version, we see that all four generals do occupy a different part of the world. Jedi occupied Japan. Europe was occupied by Nephrite occupied North America. Malachite occupied Kunzite occupied Europe. And Zoisite, I think, occupied South America.
Dark King took a moment to gaze off into the distant speck of light across the lands.
It was pretty,
I growled at with hatred. It's only a matter of time, he said. Once I have achieved my plot, the darkness will rule all, and the light will be no more. I will be the supreme ruler of all that is, and that all that will ever be.
Dude, question, what are you going to do when you are wiped out on the ensuing paradox?
But wait, what about the Black Rune Clan?
Their plan was a little bit different. They just wanted to basically decimate Crystal Tokyo and break barriers to make it easier for them to win. So that way they can ensure their victory in the future. That was all their plans were. While the Royal Crystal Palace in New Carolot, the team had their injuries treated. All they were very lucky it wasn't so serious, and they reported to their Royal Majesties. I so do love it when there's no consequences to the injuries. Ain't that great, class?
Yay!
Oh, come on, you could be happier than that. They even gave Professor Brain the blank card that they had confiscated, hoping he could find some answers.
Look at me. The brain the size of a planet, and they want me to investigate cards. Life? Don't talk to me about life.
Grand Ruler Celestial and Queen Celestia were so nemesis in the fight, by the magic rarity and lightning's his friends used.
So Rarity and Lightning decided to not help out with this? But Rarity, as of right now, is the only unicorn on the team, so why wasn't she using her magic? Or did they have somebody else take photos of the fight? Does Grand Rupert have bees everywhere? Take photos? Or did Rarity actually join in and was this a grammar error that you meant to say? Both their majesties were extremely mastified by many things, but none concerned them more than the fact that the universe itself was not enough to block the monster out of the buildings that was so strong that if Lightning had taken his risk to turn into an entacorn, things would have gotten very, very serious. Yeah, that monster might have stepped on a few toesies. Or, you know, accidentally scratched somebody. By accident.
I have never seen anything like this before, Grand Ruler said. But it cannot be ignored that we have a new enemy on our hands, which means war laws will have to be enforced to ensure safety.
This is a war! You know, if there's one thing that annoys me greatly, is when this show decides to say that these things are wars. That they sit back and wait for the MOTWs to come in and they say, this is a war. No, no, no. Wars are usually bigger than this, are a lot harder to fight, and usually can't be just limited to just saying war. Just saying, oh, we fight an MOTW and this is a war. Hell, not very many people have gotten hurt in this little so-called war of yours. But, yeah, I remind you, everybody, war laws involve the following. There's a curfew. Okay. Martial law will be declared. What? There will be no hoarding. And no price gouging. To which I say, bullcrap on that. First off, that line of dialogue is taken away from Deep Impact. And even then, even though it was said by Morgan Freeman, I doubt that those laws were true. Because in the middle of this type of situation, yeah, there's going to be price gouging, there's going to be monopolization, there's going to be people who take advantage of this. Not everybody's going to be nice about it. Second, the martial law thing seems a little extreme for just a bunch of random monsters that'll come once every 2 weeks. Or every day, considering this vlog. Three, it also feels a little, controlling. If you got me, I'm getting my drift. The others agreed. Well, except for me. But wait, said Rainbow. If the force field's weren't enough to shield everyone, then there's no safe place to run. How can we protect everyone? Very simple. You actually work hard to... Well, here's my plan. Instead of relying on the force fields, we have you guys split into teams. Somebody actually gets some of the civilians out of the way while the rest of you fight. Or you try luring the monster away from the civilians. You know, try to push them away from those civilians, or actually try to work hard to push them out of the range. Or, considering the fact that, at most, when you're at your strongest, there are, let's see, 5, 8, 6, 7 Starfleet members. That's about 13. And there's about 12 of you. That means that there are plenty of spots open to have somebody watch over the civilians, rather than relying on the force fields. We had always anticipated this would happen. We have an alternate plan, said Celestia. She turned to face Lightning and Krista, letting them explain. As commander, it was Lightning's job to advise new and alternative strategies to use against threats to the planet. And of course he figures these things out very easily, right? It was always anticipated that though the uniforce shielding in the buildings would one day prove effective, but Krista and I talked about it and came up with an evacuation strategy. If you people were watching yesterday's episode and you wanted to say that, yes, there would be no consequences for this and they would find an easy way out of their problem,
Congratulations, you've read a bad fic before. You've seen a bad this show before.
Oh, I do so love it when, you know, problems are handled easily. These bad guys are busy destroying our cities, are attacking us. Oh, I'm sorry. We fixed that the next episode. No problem, don't worry. I've seen their movie of Rainbow Rocks, and I love how their interpretation of it was for that poor girl Sunset. I do hope I actually get to meet her one day. She goes, "Oh, what was me? I have a problem with my own self-esteem because I'm afraid of my own troubles."
You no longer have them.
Hooray! Can you imagine how real life would be like if that happened? Look! That part of Ponyville's been destroyed!
We got extra buildings. Oh, okay.
Don't you just love it when these shows do that? No consequences, no problem. Now I know what you're thinking. Why do I let Sentai get away and we'll pass? Because again, not enough time to show the budget. But then again, there have been episodes of Sentai where they have shown consequences for the big monster fights. They've actually shown people getting hurt by the debris. It's not as cut and paste as you may think. Chris and I flutter over to the center of the table to face everyone. I spoke with my husband, Topaz. Oh, that's right. He has one of those. And we have agreed to a strategy to have our standby fairy soldiers come in times to warn the populace and the immediate answers to the safe planet, Swarma. I don't know what Swarma is, but I really want a taste of it. Everyone liked the idea and agreed to it. It would at least guarantee the safety of lives and make sure that there are no problems whatsoever. Starfleet. We'll make sure your difficulties are erased in one episode.
Well, that solves one of our problems, but we're still not in the clear. We don't know much about that creature, nor who sent it here, said Raimi.
He's right.
For once, said Farsai.
It's not like trying to battle 100 monsters at once. All our best attacks hardly even scratched it, even when we ganged up all on it, said Starla.
You know, considering the fact that this is a tiger, this is how the fight should have gone.
Who's a nice kitty? Who's a nice kitty?
The Master Chiefs were deeply concerned, but regretted to inform the team that there was little that they could advise.
As I've said before, Grandruler said, we ourselves have never seen anything like this. We only know as much as you all do.
I.e. very, very little. Thanks for the help, Grand Turgas!
Professor Brain entered the room.
Professor, have you found anything?
Thick!
If you're going to have a character pop up like this, please put some connections to this.
Plus, more, this character was supposed to have Celestia's dialogue. Celestia asked. Brain shook his head as he held a card.
I have analyzed the object. The card which you have given me countless times, it could produce nothing. Seen anything like this before, nor have the computers.
Wait, they have we have computers over here?
You know, the show never actually shows them using computers that much.
That would be nice to know. Do they surf the net? Over here we surf the net. That's how I've been visiting the forums.
The others all groan in dismay. Why does that sound more silly than it should?
Oh, you couldn't find anything?
So, what do we do now? Asked Buddy Rose. We know we can't beat these guys by ourselves. Unless... Lightning.
Lightning could tell what he was getting at, and immediately said, No! I'm not willing to take that risk. The last one was bad enough. I could have caused more damage or hurt someone innocent.
Look, here's the plan. Every time you go Hulk, Will does send his Starla. Problem solved.
Spoke rather severely. They felt everyone standing around.
I'm sorry. I just...
The others understood how Lightning felt. But they had to come up with some plan to get stronger.
No, don't, narrator! Thank you for pointing out the blatantly obvious! I am so glad you're here!
Sobel, I don't think ordinary training will pay up this time.
You say
one word about training under 100 times gravity, and I am swear I'll buy a brand new laptop! Says Spike. Maybe we can make our weapons stronger. Does anybody know where a goddess Hylia lives?
I'm sorry, but I'm not in this, Vic.
No, Spike. That would not be possible.
You know what would this be a good time for? To explain where these weapons came from.
Is it from their own suits? Is it from their own energy sources? Do they make their weapons a la Ruby? Do they each get their own weapons after they're done with Starfleet?
What inspires each one of them to say, I like that weapon? According to the lore, these guys happen to be the higher-ups. They are the front line. They are the top-tier soldiers. So, going by that logic, what made each one of them say, you know what would be nice? I would like to have a bow staff.
You know what would be nice? I would like to have a bow and arrow.
Did they grow up with these? Did they always like having these type of weapons? Was Starla enrolled in archery class in her orphanage? Did Artie's grandpa teach him how to use a bow staff?
What about Buddy Rose?
How does the whip work in, you know, terms of using gardening other than, you know, being a Kurama reference?
No, Spike. That would be not possible, said Brain.
He may be doing experiments with weapons and suits more powerful, but the results were highly unstable and often caused explosions in his lab, which finally searched the castle and woke up the infant foals Castle Orleani. Their masters have ordered this project to be shut down before he blew out the entire palace.
What?!
Their majesties had ordered his project to be shut down before he blew out the entire palace.
So let me get this straight, Joe! Rather than give Brain his own lab somewhere safe so he could perform these experiments to improve on the armor and give you the stuff that you need to continue to save the world, you instead told him to shut it down.
How have you been ruling this place for so long again?
But what do we do? Snapped Applejack. Look. We can't train. We can't power ourselves up. What can we do?
Again, don't anybody say one word about a 100 times gravity, training with God, training in the room of hyperspace time chamber, or doing any sort of training with the God of Destruction in order to get your hair blue.
The first thing we must do is learn of our new enemy.
Oh yeah, you did a lot of learning when it came to Raven, didn't you?
Grand Ruler.
Blank?
We must find out who he or she or they are, what they plan to do, and why.
Celestia nodded. All forces will be made aware of the situation and carry out any search for where our enemy is hiding. Once we have the information we need, it'll be much easier to deal with the danger.
You mean, once an all-out assault on the bad guys, once you have the idea of the location, know where you could go, or you could just do what you usually do?
Until then, you remain all in constant alert. If it seems that the battles are not in your favor, you may be advised to retreat.
Of course you did!
Okay, retreat, snapped Dino. But that's insane! We can't let these monsters wreak havoc on the world!
For once, I'm with Dino.
I'm with him on that. I understand your concerns, Grand Ruler said, but you all have to realize is that in our current situation, rushing into a battle we know we can't win by ordinary means increases the chances of all of you being destroyed.
Destroyed? I thought this was supposed to be rated 10 to 14. You can use the words die, kill, death, murder, mayhem, but destroyed? That's for kids' logic!
We'll enter any assistance we can, but for the moment, we'll have to play it safe. Is it understood?
I mean, yeah, millions of people are going to be in terror, people are going to die, but can't risk the frontline people now, can we?
Yep, those frontline people, fuck them.
Everyone agreed. Renali was getting late, and with the guards doing their nightly shift, Princess Luna was. Oh my god, she exists! Everyone thought of heading to bed. Krista bid everyone goodnight, and she headed home to her world, the planet Luminous.
You mean... she could have headed there the whole time? Then why was she in Lightning's room in the previous scene?
Ugh! Not thinking that thought!
Almost by morning, she had her fiery soldiers ready to help out on the long road ahead.
As most of them headed off to their rooms... So... they're just gonna stay in their rooms before heading home?
You know, everybody here has wings. Why not spend time in the castle and fly back to their normal homes in Ponyville?
It's not that far. I live in Ponyville. It's not that far from Carelot Castle from my place. My house is right here, right next to the old library. I own a bookstore. I could just leave the house right now and fly to freaking Carelot. Yeah, I won't be able to make it there as fast as Rainbow Dash, but I can fly there. We're not that far away. We're about a 2 days walk at most. Train ride. Only takes about 5 hours. Why do they all have their own rooms inside the castle? Do they live there now? Do they have apartments? Why are they there instead of Ponyville? Explain, Arthur! Explain!
Spike remained behind for a moment to gaze at the memorial library of Twilight's window. Twilight Sparkle. Twilight Sparkle. Long may she rest. The chalice containing her ashes remained safely kept well in the niece underneath.
So, instead of letting her family have the ashes, you're keeping them like you selfish pricks.
He stared sadly at the picture of the glass.
Good night, Twilight. I really wish you were here with us.
So do I.
Spike said softly. A little tear fell from his eye.
Considering the fact that I've seen the interactions between Spike and Twilight, I've always seen them as a mother and a son, I would think he would do a little more than just have a little tear fall from his eye. I know if I walked by the ashes of my grandmother every time, I would probably cry as much as I could.
I already saw him and knelt down near it softly and cuddled him close to her.
We all do, Spike, she said. We miss her, but she is and always will be with us. Just like I will always be here for you, as best as I can.
Wait, guys! I think we might actually have a true, honest to Celestia emotional moment!
Whee! Spike smiled softly and snuggled in her arms. Rarity had been a good caretaker since Twilight died, despite their few spats and disagreements. But Spike was very grateful to her.
And the narrator made me lose it!
It would have been a great emotional moment if you just removed the rest of the sentence.
Yeah, here's how to properly write this scene as done by a stem up as an amateur screenwriter.
Spike smiled softly and snuggled into her arms. Rarity could hear his soft breathing as he cuddled closer into her coat. And then she could hear tiny little sobs, sniffles coming from her new drawer. Rarity could also feel the pain in her heart as she looked at the chalice above her. The ashes containing her beloved friend. It was all she could do to cry from herself. But she knew in her heart she had to be strong for the both of them. Instead, she said to Spike the only thing that she could.
Spike, if you want to cry your heart out, I won't think any less of you. If you promise you won't think any less of me.
Spike could barely contain his sobs as he cried again.
Thanks, Rarity. Thank you so much.
And Spike continued to cry. Rarity soon cried after.
And that is how you do the scene! Meanwhile, Golden, the magic statue. Oh yeah, I forgot about you! You exist in Carelot Castle. I sometimes see you while I do my flybys. I want to kill you.
As I see you with stargazing through the telescope.
Whoa!
Wow.
The stars look so pretty tonight, he said. Suddenly, he caught the star. Sorry, two stars moving across the sky. Wow, shooting stars.
Oh, don't you know that you are a shooting star?
Shouldn't this be Starla saying that? It's her element. He suddenly noted their regular path. And they weep. Pronoun trouble. You know, it's these little grammatical errors that make me laugh. Only to cry. A little slow to be really shooting stars, and he sees the settlers over the thickets and brambles of evergreen forest, far, far away. Gee, that was strange. They just disappeared. Care to report this? Tell this to Starla? You know, little miss, I'm supposed to be an astrologist, but I don't seem to be doing my job very well. Suddenly sat down and was wondering, when he noticed how late it was getting. He felt rather tired and feeling like he would go back to his statue, which is how useful he is. Once he was tired, he rested. So he hopped onto his pedestal and removed his magic mask, turning back into a gold statue until someone would wake him up in the morning.
Here's a bit of advice. Don't wake him up!
While far, far away in the forest, two figures, one male and one female, all dressed in white monk's robes and hoods, stood in the middle of the forest, gazing at their surrounding. He said nothing, but could hear the sounds of growling behind them. They turned around and saw a pack of timber wolves snarling at them angrily. The two strangers held out their hands, and a small burst of magic at the wolves. The wolves headed away as if the magic were forcing them to leave. You know, it could have landed far away from the Everfree Forest. It didn't need to be anywhere near it. And of course it's Timberwolves. Every single one of these stupid shows I've watched decided to only use Timberwolves. The male spoke grimly. It still fascinates me that this was all like it was before. His partner agreed, but reminded him.
You mustn't let Ed forget why we're here. If we are successful, then our efforts will be in vain, and there'll be no hope for anyone.
They all walked off together, advanced to the light.
Loo-loo, skit-a-my-loo, loo-loo, skit-a-my-loo.
Birdie slept peacefully in her big bed. I wish I was on that bed with her. What, I find Birdie to be very, very beautiful. But sadly, my heart belongs to Applejack. Oh, if only she could see me from my little bookstore.
Well, Spike laid away in his little bed with his flashlight on. Click, 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 click. You know, considering that this is Rarity, I would expect him to actually have a much bigger plush bed with all the amenities.
With a little parchment and pencil, he secretly wrote something special he had been keeping secret from her and the others. And as he sat there pondering what to write next, he began contemplating whether or not he should commit suicide. He wouldn't even show it to Rarity.
A loaf of bread, a quarter of milk, a stick of butter.
As Spike tucked his parchment away, Rarity was wakened from hearing the soft sounds of paper scratching.
Spike, are you writing a portal again?
Spike, is that you? She whispered.
And once he searched, he could see him sleeping like an angel.
Well, Stephen Hawkins can't see new.
That's irresponsible. I'm sorry.
She smiled softly at him and went back to sleep. Spike peeked one eye out, sighed so softly as he fell asleep. That was a nice scene.
While everyone slept deeply, the two-headed strangers managed to sneak past all guards and any detectors.
Wait a minute.
So, is this back in Ponyville, or does everyone just have their own individual, specific rooms in Carrolock Castle? Do they each have their own rooms? Did they craft them? So, could you please explain this? I'm trying to figure this one out.
Who had figures managed to sneak past all the guards and any detectors, entering the palace.
Look, I know the guards tend to miss when something bigger or godly comes in, but they don't suck all the time!
and communicating through telepathy. I'll just make sure not to make any noise. A codec would have been easier, but that hadn't been invented yet.
Wouldn't it be easier if we just did this while they were awake? Then we could reveal themselves to them.
Yeah, I'm with Mr. Mysterious Guy and Mysterious Mysteriousness, Emil thought. But his friend disagreed.
You know as well as I do that would cause trouble.
For who?
For now, we have to do as we are told, and we'll reveal ourselves to him in due time.
Why not skip steps 1 through 6? Resisting any urge or time to argue, the two set off across the pass, slinking to avoid detection as easily as they did to get in.
Doo-doop. Doo-doop. Doo 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 doo
doo doo doo. And then took out a small walnut sized crystal. So Mamoru Chiba and Yusaki Tsukino? And they brought in the Gwen Sisa? Then, by magic, the crystals evaporated into a sprinkling soft magic. Infused into the bodies of the friend. What friend? Which friend? Their friend? Our friend? My friend? Who? Who? Thick? Who are they putting it into? And just one small...
Oi!
The sentence just got confusing. Okay. You could have said, in order to make this less confusing, you could have said, sent to the bedroom of each of the members of Starfleet, and the former bearers of Elements of Harmony. And in each of those rooms, they took out a small crystal. The way this sounds like, it sounds like they stopped inside the bedroom of each pony, which means to me that they stepped into the bedroom of every single pony who lived in that castle, then took out a small walnut-sized crystal. A walnut-sized crystal. That was singular. They didn't say specific which number they gave. So for all we know, they only took out one and went, oh. Then, by magic, the crystal of Vomerange was also marked by magic. Okay, now you've got a little problem with the singular versus pronoun. And fused to the bodies of the friends. Okay, you didn't specify. For all we know, you could say our friend, their friend. By using the as your little prerogative here, you are completely messing up the meaning of your sentence. Even Spike got one. Oh, heavens knows we needed to give Spike that one. The boys felt nothing. It just continued to sleep.
Sleep!
The duo came into Lightning and Starless room.
Well, it really is him. My god, he looks like a man.
Strain was just amazed. They gave the last crystals to Lightning and Starla.
Crystal just got ditched!
Suddenly, Lightning was beginning to stir in his wake. He was tossing, turning, and frowning.
He's having another nightmare,
the male thought. You know, this would be a nice way for Luna to show up, offer assistance, do her job. Spring nodded, and they both vanished, and a split second later, Lightning awoke softly, again gasping rather than waking up screaming.
Did I leave the stove on?
Oh, not again. He groaned, hopefully not to awaken Starla. As he felt him twisting softly, it didn't and peeked her eyes open. Feeling very worried about her husband. I wish we could see that. I wish we could see the emotions. I wish we could see the sadness. Lightning managed to shake off and fell back to sleep.
Sleep!
The next morning, Buddy Rose woke up to the sound of the alarm clock on the nightstand near his bed. When Buddy has to stay in character a lot, does he take Daphne with him? Or does he find a good babysitter? Who's Daphne's babysitter? Carrot Top? Ditsy Doo? Raindrops? Who? He raised out his hand and felt for the alarm clock.
No, no, no.
My little girl?
No, no, no.
Aha! He softly tapped a stopper, but smashed the clock into pieces in the process.
So what? I do that all the time!
I was one alarm clock that way. My mother was here about a few weeks ago and she found my, you know, sacred burial ground. Does Stan have heart to tell her that it's now a pet cemetery? gasped in shock, snapping himself fully awake. Whoops! Artie woke up and hopped out of bed, but as he set his feet to the floor, his feet smashed through the carpet and through the stone floor, making a hole into the room next below. Surely these mysterious figures of mysteriousness have brought only joy and happiness to the world! He held onto the ceiling, but was most shocked. What the? How did I do that? You can't fly! Why are you holding out to the ceiling, shocked? You can fly! You have wings! You do not have to worry! Anyway. Remy stretched out, hitting his hand on one of the four posters near to him. It snapping like a twig. How does a poster snap? Oh, for crying out loud. In that pillar! I repeat, surely these guys have given only hap and happiness to us all. On another note, considering the fact that these guys train and get super strong, wouldn't they be doing this anyway by accident sometimes? Especially early in the morning? I thought they were supposed to be super strong, super fast, and super durable. You mean they don't have problems like this frequently? This sounds more like somebody who just got super strength. Dial and Mike woke up in their shared guest room, hearing the crash. What's going on? I don't know, but it sounds like the palace is falling down. Well, I do know a couple of good deconstruction efforts, said Mike. They both hopped out of bed and placed their feet down, breaking holes through the floor just as Ari did, surprising them both.
You have weight problems.
They got up and walked to the door, and as Dial grabbed the knob, he yanked the door clear off its hinges like they were made out of paper.
What's going on here? That's what I'd like to know.
Yeah, I think we got a couple of problems here. The same for all the others as friends. You mean the other teammates? The other... Look, saying friends in every other sentence is not going to make us believe that these are a group of friends any faster! They got up, and everything they laid their hands on just got smashed, crumbled, or snapped from as simple as tuts.
Surely this was a good thing!
Spike even crumbled his own basket bed, but not a single one of them had any clue how this was happening. Well, you see, guys, once you hit a certain age, your body goes through changes. This is called puberty. Sometimes the men get bigger, more muscular. Sometimes the women go through... the women become women! Finally, lightning and starlight had woken. Lightning reached over and stalked his lovely wife's mane.
Morning, dear, he said sweetly.
She smiled and asked, having any more nightmares lately? Lightning sighed. I can't hide well, can I? I mean, sometimes I have nightmares about this beast that's trying to eat my... We would like to apologize. The previous joke has been censored, so that way we cannot go past the R rating on this show. Starla rolled her eyes playfully, but leaned forward and kissed him softly, but bopped Lightning hard in the mouth.
How do you bop him hard in the mouth with your lips?
Ow, hey, not so hard, he groaned. Starla couldn't understand, but I was moving softly. Come here, let me see.
So, the increase to strength, the increase to power, but not the durability? Oh god, your muscles are growing to be sore!
Place your own hands down on the mattress and push through it.
Not much of a mattress.
Huh? Even Lightning was surprised.
What have you done?
Starla slowly raised her hands out of the hole, still baffled and confused. Lightning slowly raised his hands and felt his wife's hands, and guessed softly.
Your hands. They feel different. Much more solid than before.
So... She's made of rock?
So do yours, Starla said.
They both couldn't resist it and slapped each other a high five, creating a massive energy wave that knocked them both off their bed and straight into the walls.
I don't see the problem. That means that's the most awesome high five in existence! High five!
Lightning's wall was the wall to the nursery, where Grand Ruler and Queen were feeding their children their bottles.
Oh, bottles, of course.
And if there, I thought Grand Ruler was doing the breastfeeding.
Deleted!
And I swear, if anybody draws a photo of Grand Ruler breastfeeding anything, I will kill you!
The mess sees Winston's sock, and the poor little foals were frightened and cried, Whee!
Lightning Dawn, what are you doing? Snapped Grand Ruler.
So they went bottle-feeding.
Okay.
I was sworn Celestia was more of a breastfeeder, but I wouldn't know. I'd like to know myself, Lightning said, got up.
There's a knock on the nursery door, and the door fell right down its hinges, making the baby's cry even more further.
Guys, maybe you should head outside or go back home.
Oops, sorry, said Buddy Rose. Celestia didn't know, she was more annoyed, confused.
Confused!
What's going on here? She demanded to know.
Krista appeared, having him warped in from her world. Morning, everyone!
And if this were a live show, this would be where the audience would start clapping.
She said, but then got to the confusing state everyone in the room seemed to be in.
Did I miss something?
All friends were taken to the sick bay. Stop saying all friends! I don't believe that they are friends. I don't believe that they are a team. Just say the group. You don't have to say all friends. The way you're acting like it, you make me think that you're trying to say that they're friends by using this word. It's not.
And the doctors cannot explain at all how, but their physical strengths have increased beyond belief.
I blame the roids.
It was definitely confirmed by comparing the readouts to the previous exam for a previous night.
So, let me get this straight. Rather than actually train hard to get more power, which would have been a great lesson to the kids to tell them, hey, when you're facing down your greatest threats, don't worry, you can actually train, get stronger, and push yourself to the limit, and you'll actually be able to conquer your greatest foes. You instead just waited for somebody to give out a Deus Ex Machina and took away all the training and all the effort. I'm so glad that there are consequences and that you have to work for something in this show. I am just so glad that, you know, you actually have to push yourself to earn something on here. It's just such a nice thing, isn't it? You know, have to work for it, have to earn yourself. Oh, no. Problems?
Well, leave the light on for you.
Didn't even work that hard for this, now did you? Oh, I'm sorry. The excuse in the earlier part of the episode was, we couldn't train.
Why? Why couldn't you train for it? You didn't leave an explanation.
God, I wouldn't even take the room spirit time by now.
Now the strengths were so high, all measuring devices and scanners couldn't seem to how to calculate how high it was.
Power levels are bullshit.
That's not possible, Grand Ruler said. Even a century of training wouldn't increase their strengths this much.
And you wouldn't know this how? Do you know how these people work? Do you know how these people do this? Do you know how training works, buddy? Actually, now that I read that line again, even a century of training wouldn't increase their strengths this much. That's something that Frieza, Cell, and various other DBZ villains say!
A stranger tonight, Applejack said. Except for our battle yesterday, we haven't been training.
I don't know. Is there such a thing as sleep training as well as sleepwalking?
Yes, Piggy wondered. But everyone dismissed the idea.
No, it's possible. Please see DBZ again.
Regardless of anything, they were now stronger than ever. Just the simplest touch was enough to break a hole through the thick walls of the palace.
I'm scared,
cried Fluttershy. She's scared of something.
Randy trembled in fear as he bit her nails, nervously muttering, this can't be happening. I must be dreaming.
I'm afraid not. We are quite awake. Just the slightest touch can make anything break. I suggest you don't play video games for a while.
Spike lifted in a huge and solid table island over his head with one hand, which he wouldn't normally be able to do.
Hold that down!
Doctor. Spike placed it down gently as he could. He still broke it. Whoops! Sorry! Whoops! Sorry again! Sorry! 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 I can sit down on purpose!
The doctors are very annoyed, but still astonished. But not as much as everyone else was.
This is incredible, said Artie.
Yeah! How did it happen?
I don't know, but check your bodies to make sure you weren't detected with steroids.
Raymond wondered aloud. Everyone pondered until their ponder was sore. There's only one explanation. It had to have been done by magic.
Say it's magic! I don't have to explain it! I dare you!
But who could have done this?
Was it you, Fiora?
Who else?
The Master Chief questioned the Royal Guard to patrol the night, but the guards had reported that no one could have entered the palace.
Again, I know the joke. I know how everybody in Ponyville sees the guards.
But it's true the guards have actually worked a lot.
I mean, they've foiled drug rings, they have foiled terrorist attacks, and they've also foiled several plots that, you know, are just not written by Twilight and the others.
The guards have actually done a pretty good job that just doesn't get reported, and I'm sorry to see that, because my kid brother wants to be a guard, and my uncle was in the Royal Guard, and they have done a lot to help out.
The security says there's a magic detector, so all checked clear as well. This began to frighten everyone. This meant whoever did this was powerful enough to be able to avoid detection of their instruments.
And they helped us!
Those fiends!
First the force field fails us, then that monster nearly crushes us, and now this?
Lightning said with concern in his voice. He's about to pound the wall in frustration, when he suddenly stopped before he broke another hole in the wall.
No, go ahead, you'll be working the Mason guys through college.
It would take a little used to, but the friends realized they had to concentrate harder on holding their excess strength back, so as not to make any more messes. That sounds like it's a really hard thing to do and would be a constant problem in your lives.
But who cares? It's easily wiped away!
Still, this could be beneficial, said Dino.
See, I don't mean we're stronger now. Is that not a good thing?
Yeah! I'm with Dino on this.
Normally I'm with Rainbow Dash, but the Majesties were not so certain.
This power was given to you by someone or something we couldn't see or don't know of.
Every party needs a pooper. That's why we picked you. Party pooper.
Her husband agreed.
Everything comes with its prices. I have a feeling this is more involved in this than we think.
Why cause us problems we don't need?
Suddenly, the alarms went off. Katarzyna rushed into the room.
Your Majesties! Your Majesties! She cried. There's trouble in the village. More than half of my guards tried to air a step, but have been seriously injured.
Oh no, they've only been injured. All those poor innocent people.
The ponies gazed at their Majesties with concern. The Grand Ruler was still very skeptical, but he knew they couldn't ignore the danger.
Go!
He said. Meanwhile, some part of him was hoping that a few equestrians would die.
Are you sure about this?
Celestia asked. Her husband agreed to her amid.
No, I'm not.
You're an ass. But the kingdom's in danger. We can't ignore their call because of mere doubt.
That's probably the only sensible thing you've ever said in your entire life, Grand Jerk asked.
He gazed out the window. She could pray he was not putting lightning in the others at risk at well.
Oh, sir, forget about the innocent souls, you know, that could possibly be needing help, but forget that.
The civilians were already in a panic, but Crystal and a team of fairies had arrived and instructed everyone to head to the portals.
Again, I still do love it that we found ways to circumnavigate responsibility.
And they were all safely on the planet Shwarma. Fairies also teleported away themselves to not get involved in extreme danger they knew was too much for them.
You know, I just thought about it, but they could teleport them to space.
Grand Ruler still raised his shields around the buildings, hoping to avoid at least collateral damage and spare the planet more destruction.
That apparently could be easily fixed!
But still, Lightning and his team made it back to the village, only to find many guards and other Starfleet fighters being critically injured all over.
Oh no! The Starfleet fighters are all laying critically injured, and there is nobody else like Lightning and his team to be able to handle the monsters.
Bravo,
Bravo.
My goodness, look at this happen, cried Rarity.
I got a feeling whoever did this is still around, said Spike.
Oh, how right you are, said a voice.
That's when he appeared.
He?
He who?
I don't know.
Habus?
Face it, you're all no match for this kind of power. I have seen the future, and none of you are in it.
They're there. They're hiding.
When he closed his fist tight, he snarled, who are you? What are you after here?
Destruction, murder, mayhem, typical things.
I am Novan, deserving of darkness.
Of course you are.
I exist only to rid all worlds of light and to spread the darkness, the chaos, in the name of Dark King.
You know, you could have another purpose rather than spread chaos and destruction, domination, conquest, subjugation.
Work with me here!
Dark King, Lightning muttered. Then he snapped himself back to senses.
Why? Was he confused?
We won't allow you or any darkness to invade our world. I'll give you one last chance. Leave now or face the consequences.
Good idea, Lightning. Let the bad guy run away.
Demon snickered sinisterly and said,
I choose this. Pokemon, go!
He raced behind him and pulled out another card, exactly like the one the ponies had found out to battle. The picture on it was like a rooster-like creature.
What's he doing?
Asked Rainbow. She soon got her answer as Demon held the card up high and shouted,
Cardinal Custerbeak, come forth and destroy these irritants.
And then threw the card away from him.
Hey! You just ruined the trade-in value!
At once, the card glowed mysteriously, and the monster appeared. A 15-foot-high, rooster-like monster with long legs and powerful rings and a round plump body.
Oh, he's going to make such a lovely chicken basket!
His beak had to be at least a yard long. The monster cowed loudly, almost like a roar. So, it was a roar, not a call then.
Still, what's with all these giant heights? I mean, these guys, 15 foot high. What, they only come up to his thighs? That's not a really interesting fight.
Oh, wait, I'm sorry, we're using Digimon logic. My apologies. The team went back.
So that's how it works, said Buddy.
Demon sniggered. And you haven't seen anything yet. You are the monster.
Kill them!
Beak cawed and lift up high, thumbing his used rings.
Whoa, a flying chicken? Cried Applejack. Now I'll sign everything. Have you ever noticed that everybody here has a,
so far the main six have had more dialogue than the Starfleet characters?
Just saying.
And more screen time!
Monster crazy down hard.
Watch out!
Cried Fluttershy. Everyone let down the way. The monster began flapping his wings hard and sighed.
Arrow blast!
Sent a powerful current straight at everyone, blowing them all away and crashing them high hard onto the ground. You know, you could go into the back.
Demon laughed quickly.
Now it's my turn. Without even having to shout his attacks.
Shock! Horror! Amazement!
I am utterly surprised by the imperial events that are happening.
He fired a stream of dark energy at everyone, creating massive explosions that threw everyone off their feet. They all quickly got up again and transformed quickly.
Starfleet magic!
Already our friendship power.
Dragon power. Change all you like. It doesn't really matter to us.
You know, they're not really changing, just putting on their armor. It's not really a transformation, just they put on a bunch of armor. It's not really transformations. Now, morphing does transformation. This is just, hey, we got armor, let's throw them on!
Let's throw on this brightly colored spandex and see what happens.
Demon sneered. His monster growl leaped up high for another pounce.
Not this time, you dude!
Snapped Lightning. He leapt up high and kicked the monster hard in the face.
Boot.
Monster roared and sent crashing down hard. Must have demon's shock.
How did he do that?
He got up, still not beaten. Fought back with all his might, picking hard at the fires and knocking them all down.
That's more like it, growled Nomad.
He then choked down, joining the fight.
Glenora Lightning as he lay down after being attacked. No more games. Your time ends now. He prepared to finish him off, but Lightning zipped out of the way and sucked Demon hard in the face, sending him skidding along the ground. Ow, 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 ow. I agree. No more games, Lightning said. Demon could hardly bleed as he rubbed his cheek. That hurt. It actually hurt me, but that's impossible. Lightning stood and glared at him from afar. Demon began to suspect something mysterious had happened to make Lightning seem so strong. It's called cheating. Lightning, Starlight called. Lightning turned to see the other still fighting out with Beak. Beak pointing his beak upward and said, Lightning Bolt.
Lightning Bolt. Lightning Bolt.
Bringing a load of lightning bolts raining down on the team. Sparks and explosions flew everywhere. I'll settle with you later, said Lightning. He didn't dash to help his friends. Demon still remained confused. Once his opponents and Spike continued to battle the monster, yet the fight seemed evenly matched. So, basically, this fic is getting bored of its own fight sequence now. So am I. Fire Rose got out his flying weapon, Apple Checker Lasso. Shall we? Let's rope this wrestler!
That is not even a colloquialism. That is just a phrase!
They all flew towards the monster, lassoing his beak shut, tying his legs together. That must have been one hell of a rope! I mean, down here, beak up there. Down here, beak down there. Pinkie Pie looked her joy.
Way to rope that rooster, she cheered.
Beak's wings were still free, and he was able to leap up high.
Whee!
And he forced Applejack and Buddy Rose away from him, also releasing his beak from the whip.
Okay, so Buddy just wrapped the whip around the beak and the rope around the legs. What?
He forced Applejack and Buddy Rose away from him, also releasing his beak from the whip. His beak free, he was able to use magic once more. Lightning Bolt.
Not much of magic, it just seems like an attack.
What's that?
Cried Fluttershy. Thank you for your assist, Flutters! The twins decided to try something before lightning struck. They held hands and said, Boom Boom Rockets.
It's all hands across the water, water.
So lightning only struck the rockets. The twins were amazed that they carried the attack.
We did something useful!
But Beak suddenly unleashed his air blast and sent everyone soaring away again.
This isn't getting anywhere. Maybe we should try our finishers.
Brilliant idea, Spike. Good idea, Artie said.
I agree, said Lightning. Group formation, now!
Formation Delta, Tango, what type of formation? And as a command, all the ponies and Spike stood together with their weapons at the ready. Magic charged.
Ready, aim.
Then they could fire. They felt their energies being absorbed.
What's happening?
Cried Rarity,
feeling very weak.
Had a rainbow. Demon then heard laughing.
Did you forget about me?
Yeah, you're kind of a loser, so yeah. He hissed as he continued to absorb your energies.
You!
Lightning cried as he got up, but his body felt too weak. You gotta love these Deus Ex Machinas. I can only help a bigger one, isn't it, about the incoming?
Take a deep breath, ponies. For it shall be your last, hissed Demon.
That one lineup doesn't work!
As he prepared to deliver the final blow, Lightning's insignia on his armor began to glow. I'll take this.
Hello?
Do something!
What's happening? Lightning muttered. They hear two voices calling to him. One female, one male.
Lightning, this is your conscience. Get out! Activate your mega mode. Activate it and you will win.
I have one of those. How do I activate what I don't even know I have? Lightning didn't understand what it was all about, but as soon as he saw Demon shouting, be gone, and fired a burst out,
Mega Float, activate it!
He quickly checked his senior. Dozen times the explosion erupted. Demon laughed louder and wicker than ever.
I did it! I win!
He cried, but his resourcing was cut short when he could see shadows through the smoke. There stood Lightning.
Deus Ex Machinas. I just don't love it when these guys don't receive any type of effort and get rewarded for no effort whatsoever.
Demon gazed out in shock while others gazed in awe. Lightning's white suit was now silvery shiny.
Oh god, it's glitter armor! With the lives!
Sarah was now padded with even stronger golden shoulder pads.
His bot armor now had a golden plate across the upper area.
Hello? Tommy Oliver? I think I found your equipment.
Spruce had golden guards around his feet. Most astonishing was a protective head care, covering more of his head than ever. Except for his ears, horn, and mouth.
The helmet sounds ridiculous! It sounds stupid.
Oh man, I needed that. Thank you. Golden riser remained. Only now, it was too greatly enhanced.
I love gold!
Lightning activated his new power. It stood in the way of the burst before it struck.
No dash, Sherlock!
While he himself only suffered some damage. Not nearly enough to even knock him off his feet.
The power, cried Demon. Just can't be happening!
Lightning,
Starlight cried softly in astonishment. Lightning looked himself all over, admiring his new outfit. But he could only find a word so he could describe what he was feeling. A mixture of feelings. Astonishment, adrenaline, confusion. But one thing he was feeling was strong. Very strong. Hey, Lightning, stop looking over your new upgrade and proceed to kick ass. For the Lord. He glared at Demon, who seemed to be shaking softly. I don't know much of this about myself, but I'm ready to see what it can do. Oh wow, a nice super mode. Almost looks something different. Demon began to fire main blast out, but Lightning swerved and twisted, evading the blast, and even deflected with one pat on his arm. If anybody needs me, I'll be going and grabbing myself a milkshake. Oh, I can see where this is going. And fired a small burst of the uniforce from his horn straight out. Arg. Harris could hardly believe their eyes.
How is he doing this?
It's called Deus Ex Machina, Pinky. We all have to suffer. I don't know how or even why, but at least you can stand up to that evil guy.
Help! You know, you could do more than just use your finishers. You could probably fight better.
Or do more.
Demon couldn't believe this, but wasn't willing to let it happen.
Buster Beak, get him! We'll be here together!
The monster roared and stretched his legs, breaking Applejack's rope. He just now decided to do that. Then both he and Demon double-teamed on Lightning, but Lightning stood his ground and fought back valiantly, punching and kicking the evil one's head hard, dealing them more damage.
Wow, I wish I could see this fight. It would be so impressive if I could actually see something.
Lightning bolt!
Beak fired his bolts at Lightning, heating them and dealing more damage.
Lightning!
Cried Sara, but her husband got up.
I'm okay,
he said. But not for long, snarled Demon. Now, have a taste of my power! He fired so many bursts of dark magic at Lightning, was he avoided by sprinting forward, zigzagging and avoiding each shot, while kicking Demon hard in the chest and sending him crashing into a tree.
Yeah, suck it to him, Lightning!
Shouted Rainbow. So much for him. Now for that overgrown canary! Beak was soaring high, straight for a failed strike, but Lightning began to power up the Uniforce. It didn't work before, but I have a feeling it may work now. Or it might not, it may look like a tool. Either way, this is gonna be fun! He fired
Uniforce!
He fired that big burst of power at Beak, blasting him in a huge explosion. Kaboom! When smoke cleared, Beak's car popped to the ground. The picture faded away. Demon clenched his fist angrily, and he snarled fiercely.
You've won for now, but don't believe this is over!
And then he was gone. The second he left, Lightning stood powered down. He was now wearing his commander's outfit once more. I felt exhausted! How much do you people want to bet he's not going to feel that exhausted later on? The others, having recovered their strength, powered their suits down and ran over to help him.
Are you okay?
Do I look okay?
I failed ready to sleep for a week. The others were still baffled by the whole thing.
Lightning, what was that?
Spike asked. Lightning wasn't sure how to answer. But suddenly he could hear those two voices speaking to him again.
You are going crazy.
You have unlocked your Mega Mode power.
So, how did I do through a test of endurance, a test of strength, a test of bravery? Then Female spoke.
It'll serve you well, throughout the hardships ahead, but you must be cautious how you use it.
Anybody else hearing that?
Me! Who's that? Who are you?
The voices didn't answer, as they were merely recording magical messages explaining the rules of Mega Mode. And the sound of the recording, please leave a beep.
Beep.
Each of you will be able to unlock your own mega modes in due time. They will greatly increase your powers for the long road ahead. But be warned,
Overusing it will have a severe effect on your physical endurance.
So, how do we unlock it? Do we suffer a great test? Do we do a great sacrifice? Do we perform a great deed? Do we just...
No, they just have it randomly.
Captains Rarity, Pinkie Pie, Rainbow Dance, and Applejack, and Fluttershy. You five will also unlock the special power to aid you as well. But you must utilize the ultimate power of the Elements of Harmony to do so.
What's the ultimate power of the Elements of Harmony?
Hey, don't you leave me out that!
We can tell you no more. The future is at stake. Hey! Don't you leave me on that note! Stop!
Save us all. The world and all its histories.
Voices said no more, and leaving the team with many unanswered questions.
L.A. and me are lightly annoyed.
Mega modes. And now the powers of the Elements of Harmony 2? Lightning asked for no one in particular.
And how come I wasn't named?
Because, Spike, nobody likes you. Even on this show, you're a scrappy. I mean, personally, you're a great reader. You read all my stuff, but, personally, I wish if you go to my bookstore, you learn to put things back! At least now they had a few answers. They knew who, or rather, they were up against. They were given new powers as a gift to help them in the oncoming battle. But they still didn't know who gave them the powers, where the enemies were coming from. Over there.
Guys, we got a lot of work ahead of us,
said Lightning, and the others all agreed, unaware that they were being watched since the battle began by those hooded strangers who they were hiding very close, but out of sight.
Blink.
They knew their first phase would be complete, but now they had other businesses to attend to. But none of them liked what they had to do next in their quest, but they knew it had to be done in a quest, whatever it was going to be.
In our next episode, Princess Cadence begins to experience terrible nightmares, which puts her through a stressful trauma that may jeopardize her adjustment and others and herself. Meanwhile, a bigger mystery has fallen upon the planet, as opponents are reported being stricken by a mysterious figure lurking in the shadows. What impact will have these nightmares have on Cadence, and what will the world think of its huge deadly mess? Nope, missed the next exciting episode of Starfleet's Magic, Waking Nightmares.
This second episode worked a little bit better to set things up, but it still fails in a lot of ways. Instead of giving us time to enjoy the emotional connection between Rarity and Spike, he just tells us in narration. It doesn't really give us time to enjoy the trauma that it affected Spike, losing somebody so close to him like Twilight. Instead, it just feels like a throwaway scene that could have been done by anything else. Also, while the foreshadowing was trying its best to work hard and give us the feeling that big bad evil is coming, it didn't really exactly give us much of anything other than this guy is for evil for real, yo. And instead, just made it feel like the bad guy's just out there laughing his butt off waiting. Once again, we get our image of the next bad guy, and all we see is just, once again, dark, mysterious, shadowy evil villain hidden in the shadows and is an undescript, unformed evil.
Woo!
Not as cool as the Nameless, I'll tell you that much, or to nothing. When it came to the Mega Modes, I really don't think Lightning did anything to earn it. These new upgrades and new power-ups were just randomly given. Nobody really worked for anything. The only reason why we're getting any explanation of why they couldn't do anything was just, we couldn't train for it. Why? We just couldn't. No, you can train for something if you work hard for it. What this basically says is, instead of working hard to overcome your difficulties, you instead just have to wait for some magical power-up to come and give you super strength and super speed. What's worse is that these mega modes just feel tacked on and useless. Like, they're just there for the additional power-up and nothing more. They don't feel like they earned anything. They don't feel like they've done anything. And this whole entire idea of the ultimate power of the Elements of Harmony just feels like it's a weak excuse to follow along with some sort of strange plan that the author has. Well, see you next time, guys.